place on the old garage on Main Ave, I believe it was called. And it was set up as a shelter, excuse me, for other homes.
This is Watertown's first audit. I have Tammy here, and she's going to share her story, how she became, she was homeless, now she has a place to stay in. And Tammy, would you share your story, please?
Yes. I actually, this would be the anniversary of my father's death 5 years ago, and that's where everything started. We lost our home on Burnup Road, where I grew up, and I spent 48 years of my life there. We left. We ended up getting an apartment in Carthage, where we had break-ins. The straw that broke the camel's back was somebody came in while my daughter and I went to work. She came with me so she could walk around town and run some errands. And while we were gone, somebody came in and killed our rabbit. We called the law, and we decided that if they could kill a rabbit, we didn't know if somebody would kill us too. So that was pretty much the last day we spent there. Within a week, we moved out. We stayed with a lady for a little while, but she wasn't zoned for boarders, so we found ourselves homeless. We stayed up at a little campsite that I know of for a few months, and then we ended up getting into the HOTUS, what used to be the HOTUS Motel. We stayed in room 8 for a year, and then we were moved into the house. The HOTUS ended up getting condemned because of a lot of the drug activity that was going on there, and we were uprooted again in November. We stayed under the awning, the pavilion down at the J.B. Wise Plaza, because other homeless people were staying there for a little while. So we decided, you know what, they've got a porta potty over there, we're gonna stay too. From there, Scott Gray took us over to the Dealmaker place on the old garage on Main Ave, I believe it was called. And it was set up as a shelter, excuse me, for other homeless people as well. That place closed, and we were since taken to the Salvation Army over here on State Street, where we slept in our car. For a little while, from when the Main Ave shelter closed up until about February when we got in here. The reason we slept in our car is because we had 3 dogs. It made it difficult. Even though we'd been searching, we couldn't find a home that would allow us to keep the 3 dogs. When Cliff Olney happened to see me at the pavilion at the J.B. Wise, he did a Facebook Live where that story began. And I guess he chose me to speak because he said I did a pretty good job advocating for the homeless people. I still intend to do and say whatever I can on their behalf. Anybody that needs to be in a home should have one. At the same thing, people that have a home should do their very best to take care of it. Whatever they can afford to do to keep it neat, to dress it up, I would say that's a plus in their direction. Now, I've only been in here going on, well, in May, it will be the beginning of the 4th month being here. I was lucky enough we had found that we could keep our 3 dogs. We have a medium large, about 50, 60 pounds. we have an older dog who is 11, Coco, who is no more than close to just a little bit over 7 pounds. And she's going to be 15 this year. Being the month that my dad passed away, it's come to the fact that my mind is on whether or not we're going to be homeless again. I spoke with the landlord today a little bit to see what he could do about getting a lease put together so that it would be a little less worrisome about losing yet another home. We like the house, we like the location. I'm trying to be responsible and try to come up with a way to pay my rent. Being on SSI, I'm not able to work. I was fired because I was disabled, even though I brought accommodations, a letter that would demonstrate how I could do my job, even though I had frozen shoulder. But they chose to terminate instead of accommodate. So this mingled in a few years ago, along with being homeless, has been a very, very bumpy road for us. We'd like to stay here. We like the house. We'd like to have something that is home, but we want to see if some restrictions can be lifted. For instance, if my Coco dog dies, and that could be any day, any time. Fortunately, she's healthy. I may have her another year or two. But when it is time, I would like to be able to replace her with another companion for my own well-being. Right now, we're told no. I have to say, I strongly believe cats are easier than dogs. They're less destructive in a house if they're female. Now, the males will sometimes spray on a wall, and I know landlords are worried about that, but the females don't. And as long as the litters are kept clean, there should be no problem. They may, however, claw the walls. That could be another issue with the landlords. But as long as the tenant offers to make good and make repairs, it shouldn't be a problem. So what I'm trying to do is for the homeless people who are like me, non-drug addicts. Drug addicts need a different kind of help. But the people like me who are non-drug addicts, we need something, a place where we can be, that we can have a home. See, I cook my meals at home. I don't always eat out. It's a treat when we get to. If we go to the drive-in movie, we take the dogs with us because we're allowed to take our dogs. Now, when Coco dies, I may get a dog, I may get a kitten, I don't know. If I don't want them to claw the walls, I'm not here trying to destruct the place, I'm trying to just live in a home. I still have yet to get a steam cleaner so I can clean my carpet because of the animals. I wanted something. First, I wanted no carpet, and I was a little worried about dogs having accidents. And as you know, that always happens. So I am now probably either this month or next month going to get I'm going to try to purchase a little lightweight Bissell steam cleaner where I can put a pet carpet shampoo in and eliminate the mud and the dirt and pet odors and things like that. So I'm one tenant that tries to take care of a place. It's hard to afford it sometimes. We need low income, and the rent here will be approximately $800. And the apartment next door, this is a duplex. As far as I know, he's going to be renting the other one out as well. And we don't mind having neighbors at all. We're fine with neighbors. We're friendly people. I'm hoping I can plant flowers. I'd like to spend Christmas here because the window behind us is where I'd like to put my Christmas tree. And I'm hoping I can prepare my holiday dinners here. And we, as I said, I like the area. We're within walking distance to the food pantry, to a little store down the road, even to my church that I go to, we're within walking distance. My daughter is, she makes appointments at Nurkle, and she's also looking for employment. She's great at math. She would make a great cashier, but she has a condition too, where people aren't so tolerant of it. She's got what they call fish odor syndrome. And that is something to do with the metabolism. And not when the food digests, it turns into toxins. And then it pours out in her sweat. And it's, people have described it as rotten egg smell, dead fish smell, cat urine smell. They've described it as all kinds of things. And it's none of that. It's just the toxins coming out. She also has anxiety disorder. So today started out pretty awful for her because being the day that her grandpa passed away, excuse me, very rough on me, but we have come a long way since then. And we're just hoping that it can be a steady progress. It's slow, but it can be a steady progress. We are trying to seek help from different agencies so that we can pay rent. We're not going to be able to do it out of pocket. We don't get that much money. $800 is, I would say, medium low rent. It's not low low rent, but it can be affordable with agencies' help. We're trying to get HUD, but I don't know how that's going to work out. We're also hoping that maybe there will be some other available programs for us in the future. And if there is any, I'm hoping that people will reach out and let us know. So that, and if my address, well, my phone number, if it has to be put out, we can do that. And they can contact us. Now, I'm not looking for prank calls. I'm not looking for bogus calls. What I'm looking for is if the agencies can help us to get our rent paid. We have to start paying rent at least by August 1st. We were put in this program for a 6-month trial. And that's going to be over by August 1st. So if any agencies can reach out to me that they're willing to help us pay the rent will be $800. We're hoping my daughter can get back on her public assistance. We're hoping we can get the landlord to get us a lease so that we can get these things lined up to start paying our rent. And the phone number they can contact is, if it's okay to put it out, is 315-408-1935. That is my cell phone that if they call or text, they can call or text it, tell me what they can do, and if they can help, I would sure appreciate it. I do appreciate all the help these people have given me so far, but we're not out of the woods yet.
My question to you, Tammy, is, that's a wonderful story. Is what's your biggest worry and struggle as you talk to the audience about you possibly becoming homeless? And what's your deepest worry that might happen or outside?
Because when the 6 months is over and we can't pay rent, I know we can't live here for free. That wouldn't be right. My worry is that we'll be stuck back in the car and that we probably won't find another place that'll allow us to keep the pets. And that we'll be stuck in the car again all winter. I don't know if my car will pass inspection. I won't know that until the 2nd of May. I'm hoping it will. because if we have to, it's there and we can live in it. But I like cooking on a stove. I like being able to lay down in a bed to sleep. My ankles were so swollen the last time, I could barely even walk when I had to sit up in the car to sleep. If anybody has ever done that, they'll know what I'm talking about. 2 days is one thing, but wow, 2-3 months is another. And so it's medically not a good idea to sit up sleeping in a car. The worry is that without the help, that's where we're going to be.
We also came here to Tammy, as I heard your story and you spoke up at the city council meeting and with the help of Cliff, and that's a good thing. And I also believe people need more help. So
yeah,
the reason why we're here is to hear your story and also to put a light on the homeless crisis we have in the city.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
And also, we came here to bless you and to help you in this need. So we want to give you this money to help take care of that need. It's not a lot.
It is a blessing.
And we really do appreciate this story, because if more stories get out that there needs to be more done in services and just the understanding of what's it like to be homeless. I personally don't know, but my family grew up poor. You know,
yeah,
we had to struggle and get through however way we do, and
yeah,
it's tougher now.
And that's just it, though. Family is a good key word here. Mm-hmm. When there was six of us when I grew up, my dad, mom, and us four siblings, and we never, even though we were poor, we never faced homelessness. We always had a home. We were always taken care of. And my dad made sure of that. And even in his later years, when my mom passed, one of my brothers passed, my brother and sister moved away, and it was me, my dad, and my daughter staying on Burnup Road, he always was there to help. And when he passed, it was a huge income loss. And that was partly why we lost our home. But it takes family working together to make it work. I would suggest that if you're a young person still living at home, don't knock it. Don't be in a hurry to leave. Help your family with expenses. Work with them any way you can. My daughter and I, she's an adult. She's almost 30, a couple of years, and be on her own. It was a close call today, though. She likes to take care of cats. She wants to do something to help in sheltering or working with some sort of sheltering of cats. She said that there's a connection. My brother always, always loved cats, and he was like a cat magnet. And my daughter, that's her uncle, she sort of picked it up, and she said it's like a bond, a link between her and her uncle. So cats mean more to her than just four-legged creatures. They mean something deeper. And that's why she likes to help take care of them. And she would like to do something to do more for that. They seem to like her because of her fish odor syndrome. She smells like fish and they don't care. So I think it'd be good if she could find something in that field, but it has to be a paid position. And I know she would love it. She would absolutely love it. She could spend time with cats. We're not allowed to have cats here. That's why she was a little upset. She was going to leave. And I told her, I said, how are you going to do that? You have two dogs. How are you going to leave with everything on your back trying to walk one dog who spins and another one who's afraid of traffic? So I talked to her and I said, look, I'm not looking for you to leave, But you have to realize it's rough out there. And I go right back to this. Family has to help family. They have to be, they've got to work together on things. Now, I want my daughter to be happy. I want her to succeed. And I want to be there to share that, whether I live in the same home or close by. You know, I want her to be okay. And that's a mother's job. I didn't give birth to a child to dump her off in the middle of anywhere. She was born with, I believe, the makings of cerebral palsy. It was never diagnosed. She had all the symptoms, the learning disabilities, anxiety disorder, tight heel cords, poor eyesight, motor control issues, and a little bit of behavior problems, the fish odor syndrome. But my brother was also disabled. And I grew up in a family where you look after your family if they're disabled. My daughter found making friends pretty easy, but school, not so easy. They failed her in almost every subject, but she's way better at math than I am. She should have been getting hundreds and A pluses and A plus pluses in math, and I would more or less get C's and B's. I think society needs to do more.
And I would ask you, what would be your message, your closing message to tell people and to just give them hope and inspire that whatever situation they face, that they can come out of it? What would be your words that you would tell the audience?
Having the bumpy road that I've been on from birth to present date, growing up, knowing the struggles, not really being wealthy, but somehow we get by. Then my family slowly, one by one, disappears. All the heartaches I've been through, all the bumps in the road, the homelessness, the losing of pets, I should have been the drug addict. I would have had every excuse to become one, but I didn't. There's no excuse good enough to just get into drugs. If you get into drugs, you worsen the problem. You can't correct something if you make it worse. It's a longer road back. I decided that a person has to be strong. They've got to sometimes give themselves a pep talk. And they've got to stay away from the drugs because they'll get better jobs. They have a better chance of getting into apartments. Some people feel the hopelessness. And I understand that. Believe me, I've been through a lot of that. But I would never want them to turn to drugs. It would make things worse. If any drug addicts now are out there homeless, if they can get into a program and get help and keep away from the drugs once they get that help, they can actually become responsible, productive citizens, which is what I'm trying to do too. Right now, I'm using money from the taxpayers and the goodness of other people helping me. But I want to be one of the people someday that does some of the helping instead of being the one helped. And if everybody gets a mindset like that, then things can work out. It's not just a dream. Life is what you can make of it, what you can do for others, and what they do in return for you. Pay it forward when you can. Do everything you can to be responsible for whatever you're doing in your life.
And we thank you, Tammy, for your story. It blessed me, my wife. We really thank you. I thank you for your time, Tammy.
I appreciate you doing the story, too.
we will get another story, and hopefully we will help as much as we can to tell as many people as we can, and, mm-hmm. and get the help that that you need.
Yeah, I appreciate you doing it. That's gonna
thank
be
you.
Thank you.